Hi everyone, today in my presentation I will be exploring how the objectification of women is portrayed and reinforced by film. I would like to thank my professor Billy Gunn for helping me in my research. When we were discussing film, it is really important to note how film and society work in a feedback loop. This means that film reflects society values while also being able to influence society. Therefore, it's really important to dissect how certain groups of people are portrayed in films since they have the power to impact society. In my research, I will be exploring how the blatant objectification of female characters is clearly present when analyzing classic Hollywood films through their use of the male gaze. In modern cinema, this objectification has transitioned into something more subtle, yet equally problematic, which is including female characters who have an illusion of power and agency in the film, but they are actually just used as ways to serve the male protagonist's character development. Two key words that are important in my research are objectification and hegemonic patriarchy. The objectification of women basically means that women are being seen as objects. There are lots of ways to objectify someone, and there's a lot that goes into this theory, but I'll be exploring two specific components of it, which are how female characters are often reduced to their body and their appearance, and they're often reduced to being used as a tool for the male protagonist's character development. This portrayal of women in cinema and this overall objectification of female characters connects to a really large society issue, which is that we live in a hegemonic patriarchy. Film is vastly controlled by mostly men who are mostly white, and they have the power to reinforce harmful stereotypes in their film, which therefore reinforces these stereotypes in society as well. It has gone to the point where they have created a culture that's so normalized that those who are negatively affected by it don't realize it. In order to really understand how classic Hollywood films like Psycho blatantly objectify female characters, it's really important to know how the male gaze works and how this plays into Psycho. The male gaze was a term created by Laura Mulvey, who was a revolutionary film theorist and critic. Mulvey argues that society is structured to benefit the patriarchy, and film positions female characters as only objects for the heterosexual male desire. The male gaze theory states that the camera is never a neutral observer. Instead, it forces all the viewers to assume this heterosexual male point of view. The male gaze portrays women as sexual objects and as passive characters who serve the male protagonist's desires. This causes the audience to identify with the camera that is objectifying the woman and the male protagonist, who is also objectifying the characters, as they, the viewers, also will be objectifying the female characters since they are taking on this role. This type of blatant objectification of women can be seen really clearly in Psycho, which is a classic Hollywood film directed by Alfred Hitchcock. These two shots are from the famous shower scene where the main female protagonist, Marianne, gets murdered by Norman Bates while she is naked taking a shower at the Bates Motel. In this shot, we only see the camera focus on Marianne's stomach. The camera dismembers her body parts, and this is a prime example of how the camera in the film is objectifying Marianne and reducing her to only her body parts. We don't see her head or the rest of her body. It's just a simple shot that cuts off everything else and dismembers her. Even in her death scene, her last scenes in the movie, the scene is catering to the male gaze as Marianne is being sexualized and objectified in her last moments. Also, it is later revealed in the film that Norman killed a woman who he was sexually attracted to, meaning that his sexual attraction was the cause of her demise, and she was only a passive object who was receiving this attraction, and yet she ended up being killed. Marianne Psycho is a prime example of how a lot of classic Hollywood films portray women as sexual objects, and the way the camera focuses in on Marianne's body in this scene is a really great example of this type of visual dismemberment that cameras do to female bodies a lot of times. This type of blatant objectification is much more common in female characters than male characters. In a 2018 study done by USC Annenberg, they found that women on screen are at least three times as likely to be shown in sexy attire, showing some nudity, or referred to as attractive than male characters. This study really reinforces Laura Mulvey's theory, which states that film is catering to the heterosexual male point of view, and in turn, it is sexualizing female characters at a much higher rate. Over time, as modern society and cinema has evolved, This type of obvious blatant objectification, like the one in Psycho, has transformed to something that's a little less obvious, but it's just as problematic, which is how female characters are being developed and portrayed in film. In modern cinema, female characters are often used as plot devices to serve the male protagonist's character development, rather than having their own storylines, agency, or power in the films that they are present in. A recent study done by researchers who analyzed over 180,000 sentences from recent movies found that female character plot lines in movies are mostly focused around romance and relationships. On the other hand, male characters' plot lines also focused on these two topics, but they included a wide range of other things like career and family, which means that their plot lines were much more diverse than female characters who were forced to fit into a very small character trope. A really common way that female characters are stripped of their agency in films while still being visually represented in these films by being casted is through common Hollywood tropes. The first trope that I'll discuss briefly is the final girl and Madonna whore complex. The Madonna whore complex is a theory that states that women are either Madonnas who are worthy of men's love but too pure to be desired, or whores who are not worthy of love since they are not virgins. This misogynistic theory plays into the final girl trope, which occurs in horror movies, where the last girl alive is always, or most of the time, the girl who abstained from not drinking or having sex and who is quote-unquote the most pure out of all of them, and that is why they live. And the second trope that I'll be going into more detail with is the manic pixie dream girl. This trope is basically when these characters are being portrayed as whimsical, quirky, and just quote-unquote not like other girls. Instead, the manic pixie dream girl sole purpose is to bring meaning into the male protagonist's life and to aid or to inspire him in his character development. This type of trope leads to female characters being used as props to develop the male characters and reduces them to a mystical stereotype, and it just strips them of any power agency they have in these films. A really great example of a classic manic pixie dream girl is Summer from the movie 500 Days of Summer. The film follows the male protagonist, Tom, as he falls in love with Summer, who makes it clear that she does not want a relationship. And later on, Tom is heartbroken when she again makes it clear that she does not want a relationship. Summer's name is in the literal title of this film, and it gives this illusion that she's going to be this developed, full character throughout this movie, but it ends up being a disappointment because she just falls into the manic pixie dream girl trope, and we don't see much of Summer rather than seeing her in scenes with Tom, or seeing how Tom thinks of Summer. In this scene, Tom is describing how he is describing all the things that he loves about Summer.
I love the smile, I love her hair, I love her knees. I love this heart-shaped birthmark she has on her neck. I love the way she sometimes licks her lips before she talks. I love the sound of her laugh. I love the way she looks when she's sleeping. She's like the wind. I love how I hear this song every time I think of her. I love how she makes me feel. Like anything's possible. Or like, I don't know, like life is worth it.
As you can see, Tom is only listing either physical attributes of Summer or how she makes him feel. This scene of Summer not only sexualizes her through the camera angles, but also pushes the narrative that Summer is only a plot device who's bringing meaning to Tom's life. She is simply just the manic pixie dream girl trope, and throughout the film, she becomes villainized because we are watching this film through Tom's perspective. Tom does not understand that Summer is a multidimensional human being, and since the movie is through Tom's perspective, many viewers falsely don't understand that either and villainize Summer. And overall, it's just a negative portrayal of a character who could have been very well developed. The effects of not only just this blatant objectification, but also the more subtle objectification through character tropes, is that it reinforces this idea that a woman's role is just to be a sexual object or tool to inspire or to aid men. As stated, society and film do work in this feedback loop, meaning that the objectification of women is harmful to society as a whole. Studies show that a lot of individuals build their beliefs and perceptions about themselves through mass media, so portraying these really negative stereotypes can lead to really detrimental effects. It's a really common misconception that these negative portrayals of women aren't as present today, but in modern film, there is still a really large issue with women not being represented behind the camera and in front of the camera. There's a clear lack of women entertainment professionals that are on set, as you can see in these graphs, in these charts. Although just simply hiring women doesn't necessarily mean that women would better represent on screen, it is a really great step in the right direction. Studies show that in male-directed movies, female characters are often put into situations that require male characters to save them rather than having the power to save themselves. An accessible way that any viewer or production can see if a movie passes the bare minimum of seeing if they're fully representing a female character in a positive way is to see if they pass the Bechdel test. The Bechdel test asks if there are at least two named women who have a conversation with each other about something other than a man. Although this test seems quite simple and not doesn't have the strictest rules, from the 1,200 highest-grossing films from the past 40 years, less than half of them pass the Bechdel test. On the other hand, 95% of these films pass the reverse Bechdel test, which has the same criteria but asks if there are two named men who have a conversation about something other than a woman. Although this test seems simple, the amount of films that fail it prove that women are still being heavily underrepresented in films, and if they are on screen, they're not being full developed characters who even have conversations about something else other than a man. They're just there to aid the other characters' developments. As I stated before, a possible solution to this issue of objectifying women in film and pushing these harmful stereotypes is by hiring more women in these key roles. Statistically, movies that have female directors tend to portray female characters in a more positive light compared to male directors. Furthermore, another possible solution is to continue advocating for this issue and for better representation of women in media and funding for research that focuses on this. For example, the Gina Davis Institute of Gender and Media has done amazing work over the years about doing research on examining intersectional on-screen representation, and they're a great source for more information about this issue. The third possible solution is, I think, what I believe one of the most important ways to end this ongoing objectification and misrepresentation of women in films, and is by highlighting the stories of women as full characters, rather than subjecting them to fit into a trope. Portraying women in films in a more positive light and fully developing them as characters who have agencies over their own lives will positively impact society because it will lead to better represented gender roles in media and influence society in a more positive way. Thank you.